Between Europe and the United States, coronavirus has devastated some of the world's best-resourced countries. But public health experts say the biggest threat to global health may still be ahead of us as COVID-19 sweeps across Africa. Dr. Penny Milsom is a researcher in global public health governance and policy at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. She also volunteered in Liberia with the Ebola response. And a short time ago, I asked her about that experience.
So I went to Liberia with the intention of working in Ebola treatment unit, and I guess my experience was a classic experience of the rapid evolution of what happens in outbreak settings. So we went there with the intention of working in Ebola treatment unit, and we ended up re-establishing a hospital, a local government hospital that had been essentially overrun by Ebola with, you know, many health workers dying, and the hospital collapsed essentially. So we revitalised the hospital and developed the necessary infection prevention and control strategies and procedures so that we could attempt to open the hospital safely, albeit with extremely limited resources.
Obviously, Ebola and coronavirus are very different infections, but what did your experience responding to that outbreak in West Africa teach you about the resourcing of those countries?
So, you know, it goes without saying that these countries are some of the poorest countries in the world, and they simply have they have health systems that are terribly under-resourced at the best of times. That they can't manage, you know, regular health conditions, let alone the huge surge of patients that come in an outbreak setting. So, you know, the weak health systems really come to the fore in these kinds of situations. Mm. I would say the second thing would be that social capital, so trust between government and the people, trust between people themselves, and also the trust that the government has in their people, really becomes extremely important during an outbreak. And it's not something that you can build overnight. It's something that governments need to invest in the long term by providing social services, by providing health services in an equitable way to their populations. And this hadn't been happening in West Africa because these governments are hugely under-resourced. So we had enormous problems with rumours, with lack of trust of health workers, of NGO workers as well. Mm. People were not presenting to Ebola treatment units to be cared for, and they were out in the community spreading Ebola, and the effects were catastrophic. So it wasn't until we really engaged with communities, we engaged with community leaders, that the response really started to turn around, and communities took leadership of the response within their families, within their communities.
What do you expect will happen when coronavirus progresses more in Africa?
So, I think particularly in West Africa, having had the experience of Ebola, these governments are extremely aware that if they don't contain it in the very beginning, then they are on the way to outbreaks with much worse outcomes than what happened during Ebola. And we were talking about 11,000 deaths just in West Africa, so they're extremely concerned. You know, these people, COVID-19 and corona will spread more rapidly in these settings. People live in slums, they live very close to each other. They don't have access to clean water, they can't afford to buy hand sanitizer. So the infection will spread very rapidly in these communities. And then the second thing I would say is that we need to be thinking about people in low-income countries, because although they don't have very old populations, they have people who are extremely immunocompromised. They have huge numbers of the population who suffer from tuberculosis. In many African countries, HIV, South Africa has a 14% HIV rate in their population. Malnutrition is, you know, just rampant across Africa. All of these conditions weaken the immune system and could well make people vulnerable to moderate and severe infection from COVID-19. And that, coupled with extremely weak health systems, these hospitals, we're not talking about respirators in these hospitals. There's one respirator in the entire country of Liberia of, you know, 5.5 million people. They don't even have oxygen cylinders. So you know, we're going to see people dying from not just severe or critical infections, but people dying from moderate infections that just, you know, wouldn't happen in developed countries. So it's huge concern. It's concerning.
I know there is concern from epidemiologists as well that if coronavirus proceeds, you know, quickly throughout Africa, that potentially the virus can mutate, which would render a vaccine unusable.
I think it's a concern that people in the wealthy world would be only concerned about people living in developing countries because of the fear that if we don't provide support to them to respond effectively, then the outbreak could come back in for the second wave in wealthy countries. Of course, that is a concern, and that may well happen. But I think if we are truly all in this together, as I think a number of the leaders, global leaders around the world are saying, then we need wealthy countries need to step up and start showing support for developing countries because they're going to need huge resources and technical support to respond.
What do you make of New Zealand's response so far?
I think the decision to lock down when New Zealand did lock down was necessary. We didn't know the level of community spread, and New Zealand just didn't have the capacity, the ICU capacity, to be able to handle a huge surge of people needing that high level of care. So I think that decision was right. It's a little unclear now where to from here. So I think those things need to be really clear and transparent in the public and in the public domain so that there can be debate around it. I think we also need to be really thinking about the unintended consequences of a lockdown. You know, we have people, huge levels of domestic violence in New Zealand. Are we thinking about those kids and those women who are subject to domestic violence in their home in a lockdown situation? Are we thinking about our Pacific community who perhaps have, you know, three generations living under one roof and the risk of familial transmission within the family group? So I think we need to be having all these people around the decision-making table so we can, as we make decisions along the way, we can be anticipating the possible unintended consequences of the actions that we're taking.
And in a global sense, what are the lessons we can take from coronavirus?
I think certainly in the short term, this outbreak has really shown us how interconnected we are, across countries as well as within our own communities. So I think that's one thing. I think people are turning inwards at the moment and building strong communities, but I think we also need to be looking outwards and building very strong collaborations across country borders. But in the longer term, I think that this provides an opportunity for us to really look at the inequalities in our countries and within our countries, because inequalities are inevitably going to make this outbreak worse. People who are in situations, you know, living in refugee camps, people who don't have access to clean water, people who live in slum settings, in these situations, the outbreak is just going to spread rapidly and people are going to be, you know, devastated. So I think this, you know, while we're thinking about all the people who are being affected by this and now in terms of people who are losing loved ones. But I think in the long term, we need to think, really take this opportunity to address these inequalities and put social justice at the centre of political decision-making to prevent the devastation that these outbreaks can cause.
Dr. Penny Milsom. Kua mutu, that is us for Q&A this week. Thanks for watching. Ngā mihi ki a koutou I ngā karere. Thanks for your contributions. Stay safe. Get some appropriate exercise. Keep in touch with your loved ones. We have decided, given the circumstances, we are going to do a show next weekend. Easter Sunday. Hei te wā. We'll see you then at 9 o'clock.